Welcome to Life Devotions, and thank you for joining me today. Today's title is, I Will Make You. And that's simply from Genesis chapter 12, where God calls Abraham and says to him, I will make you. And I want to put this word in your heart today to strengthen your faith and to help you look up to him who will never fail to complete the work he has begun. David says in one of his powerful psalms, Psalm 138, verse 8, Lord, do not abandon the work of your hands, but perfect or complete that which concerns me. And God will not give up on you. And I understand in my own life, you know, I'm on my 60th year, and sometimes it feels like it will never happen because your faith is having to grow roots deeper into Christ so that you can daily live out of the nourishment that you receive from your union with him, the life-giving spirit that you receive through your union with Christ. And that fuels that faith, that makes that faith so living and so real and so powerful, that the things that you hope for become real to you, the things that you cannot see become an experience in your spirit. And this is the wonder of our union with Jesus, that God has recreated us in Christ for the good works that he has prepared for us to walk in. You'll find this in Ephesians 2 verse 10, but I want to take you first here to Genesis chapter 12, starting at verse 1. Now the Lord had said to Abram, get out of your country and from your family and from your father's house to the land that I will show you. And it's important for you to realize, if you look at Stephen's sermon, I think that's in Acts chapter 8, I think it is, where Stephen says that the Lord called Abraham when he was still in Mesopotamia. Mesopotamia was a part of land by the Euphrates River. The reason that Abraham was called the Hebrew, because the Hebrew means from the other side, or who's passed over. I find it so powerful when I think of the Passover lamb, that actually that's part of what the meaning of that word Hebrew is, he who's passed over from the other side. And Abraham was called by God, but there was a time, there's quite a time that went in there, because his father Terah, the father of Abraham, had his own journey, and Abraham was honoring his father until his father passed away, and then he was able to continue. So the Lord says to him in verse 2 of Genesis 12 here, I will make you a great nation. I will bless you and make your name great, and you shall be a blessing. And I will bless those who bless you, and I will curse him who curses you. And in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed. The Apostle Paul in Galatians 3 verse 8 says that God preached the gospel to Abraham here when he said to him, in you all the families of the earth will be blessed. But God said to Abraham, and this is what I would like you to see today, I will make you. And it's the next verse says, and Abram departed as the Lord had spoken to him. He went on the journey of God making him. And when you come to Christ and Christ comes to live in your heart, you have started on the journey of God making you. Oh yes, the moment you receive receive Jesus as personal Lord and Savior, in God's eyes, you are made perfect. It's just like a baby that is born. The moment it is born, it's amazing. It's perfect. It has fingernails. It has eyelashes. It has tear ducts. It's amazing if you look at it, how amazingly beautiful that baby has been made, fearfully and wonderfully, as David would say in Psalm 139. But then it grows and it matures and it develops, and the personality of that child begins to emerge over time into adulthood and so forth. And the same is true about you and me in Christ. The Lord is the one who makes us. I love that Psalm 100. it is a psalm to take to your heart, the whole psalm really. Let's just read that psalm for just a moment. Psalm 100. Oh, what a good psalm that is. Thank God for the word. It says here, make a joyful shout to the Lord, all you lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Know that the Lord, he is God. It is he who has made us, and not we ourselves. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise, and be thankful to him and bless his name. For the Lord is good, his mercy is everlasting, and his truth endures to all generations. You know, today the Lord is not by any means lifted his molding hand or spirit from you. He is making you and molding you, even if maybe you're going through trying, testing times. Then often in those times, we are actually being made most deeply and intimately into what the Heavenly Father is working by his Spirit in our lives. However, I understand, and we're going to Romans chapter 4, verse 17, I understand that it can be challenging to your faith when you can feel so human, so earthly, so natural, and maybe are passing through Romans chapter 7. What is Romans chapter 7? It's the journey to Romans chapter 8. In Romans chapter 8, you can see how we are what we are by the Spirit of the living God, children of the living God, well-pleasing to him, led by his Spirit. We can see how we experience perfect righteousness with him by the Spirit of Christ in us and live free from the law of sin and death. That's Romans chapter 8. But in chapter 7, we are all of a sudden shown what is right in God's sight and not. And yet we cannot do what is right. We only do what's wrong. And we say, oh, wretched man am I, for what I want to do, I don't. And what I don't want to do, I do. Who will deliver me from this body of death? And you see, that is such an important part of the journey, that you begin to realize your own weak human nature that falls short of God's glory, and that you cry out with a deep cry to God, have mercy upon me, a sinner, and save me. And then begin to experience the very purpose and power of Christ coming is to save us from our sins by creating us a new heart and a new mind by his indwelling presence, and by causing our nature and character to become like his, that for which God had predestined us. Oh, it is absolutely marvelous. It's most wonderful when you begin to cry out to him in your weakness, and you begin to cry out in your impotence, you know, your barrenness of nature, and you say, oh Lord, I know what you want from me, but I'm not doing it. And I cry out for mercy, Lord. And you see, then you begin to experience the work of his mercy. It is not he who wills, nor he runs, but it is he who shows mercy that determines our salvation. We're not saved by any work of our own righteousness, but we're saved by the mercies of God, by making us new inwardly through his Holy Spirit, he says in Titus 3. And here we see the spirit of faith that God gave Abraham, that he's given to you and me as well. It says, as it is written, I have made you a father of many nations in the presence of him whom he believed, God, who gives life to the dead and calls those things which do not exist as though they did. God calls you his own child, holy, acceptable, and well-pleasing in his sight, when it absolutely seems impossible naturally. When naturally speaking, you have so many things in which you fall short of his glory, and yet God declares you not guilty in his sight. How is that possible? All because of what Jesus has done for you. All because of the work of his grace that has begun in you. And you need to trust him like Abraham, that he will complete that which he has begun. He will not fail to make you all he's called you to be. And it's in the journey that you come to know his forbearing goodness and kindness, so that you, like him, may become forbearing and good towards others. And in the journey, you begin to experience his faithfulness and truth, so that you may become faithful and honest and upright in your ways. Oh, the journey is actually so important. It is where you begin to know him who is faithful. Oh, the Heavenly Father is so faithful. Listen to this. It says here, Abraham, who contrary to hope, in hope believed, so that he became the father of many nations according to what was spoken, so shall your descendants be. And not being weak in faith, he did not consider his own body already dead, since he was about 100 years old, and the deadness of Sarah's womb. He did not waver at the promise of God through unbelief, but was strengthened in faith, giving glory to God and being fully convinced that what he had promised, he was also able to perform. Therefore, it was accounted to him for righteousness. You see, the righteousness that we are given by God in Christ Jesus comes to us simply by faith in Christ alone. Oh, praise God that God gives us right standing with himself, and that what he has promised us to be in Christ is what he makes us to be by his Spirit at work in us. Believe that all God has called you to in Christ, he works in you by his Spirit. Put all your trust and faith in the working of the Spirit of God in you, making you, forming you, shaping you. The Apostle Paul, when he was having to suffer the pain of the church of Galatia, the Galatian church, of their embracing again the old ways of the law by which they thought they would be made perfect as Christians, he felt the pain of that human nature that through the law becomes aware how short it falls, how weak it is, and how unable it is to please God. And he says, oh, who has bewitched you to go back into the old way when it brought nobody to righteousness? The law made nobody perfect. It is through Christ that we are made right in God's sight. How can you go back there? And Paul says, I travail in chapter 4, I think it is. I travail in birth that Christ be formed in you. In other words, I am weeping and praying for you to see the life of Christ emerge and spring up in you, like Jesus said in John 4, like a fountain of life that springs up within you. Oh, dear friends, the making of God is so wonderful. I am so grateful to know that my Heavenly Father is my maker. And I want to say this to you as I start closing. I want to take you to Hebrews 13, please. But I want to say this. You know, my dear wife, Virginia, we've been married 37 plus years now. And you know what I love her for so much? Many things. But most of all, because she's never given up faith that God would make me, even though at times that seemed very hopeless and seemed very impossible, because I was so barren, so humanly barren to what God was wanting me to be. But praise the Lord. The scripture says in Isaiah 54 that the barren one will cry with joy, because many more will be the children of the barren one than of her who is with child. Oh, it talks about how through Christ we are given this life. We're given this new nature, this new character. It is wonderful, friends. It's wonderful. Be encouraged about yourself. Be encouraged about others. Have faith in God for them, and have faith for them and in them that God will make them. Don't give up on one another, even if it seems hopeless. God is able. He is able to do far more than we could dare ask, hope, or pray. Let me close with this scripture in Hebrews 13, okay? It's verse 20 and 21. May the God of peace, he who is the author and giver of peace, who brought again from among the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, the shepherd of the sheep by the blood that sealed and ratified the everlasting covenant, strengthen complete, perfect, and make you what you ought to be. And this is why I read this to you. Have faith that God, through the everlasting covenant in the blood of Jesus, is able to make you. Believe. Believe because of that covenant through the blood. Believe because of that new covenant power that is eternally powerful, eternally able to give life to the dead and to make us what we ought to be. Believe that it is strengthening you. It is completing you and perfecting you and making you what you ought to be and equipping you with everything good so that you may carry out God's perfect will while He Himself works in you that which is well-pleasing to Him through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever. You're gonna see the miracles of God making you. And sometimes it can be quite a journey. Why? Because the roots in us take time sometimes to be uprooted. The roots of certain natures in us takes time to be uprooted, but the Lord will not give up to uproot certain behaviors until they're fully crucified, fully surrendered, and you become a transformed person living in the rest of the Holy of Holies, in the blessed calming presence of our Savior Jesus, day and night while you're in this body, where you can say, it's no longer I that liveth, but Christ lives in me. Amen. Have a good day.